Have you ever wondered how green your city is compared to other cities, or even compared to how green it needs to be if we want to have a long, prosperous future on this planet? Now, green is sort of a shorthand for a healthy ecosystem, and in a healthy ecosystem, life is layered, meaning that all of the resources that come into the system, the sunlight, the rain, the nutrients, are cycled among many living beings before they leave the system. And this is what makes ecologies rich. Unfortunately, when humans clear land to grow our own food, our agriculture is not layered. There's typically one species between earth and sky, especially on large industrial farms. And so, as we've occupied half the land area of the earth, we've wiped out half the life on earth. And even down to the microbial level, conventional farm soils have 99% less biodiversity than healthy forest soils. So many of us are starting to wonder how we can live lighter and greener on the earth. And we begin to realize that the task is bigger than what an individual or a family or even a small group of people can handle on their own. The question is more like, where can we live lighter on the earth? And unfortunately, this slide and the previous slide can end up being ecologically almost the same thing because of our habit of delayering natural systems around us. That's why in today's episode, I'll be getting into a way to rate cities in a very holistic way so that cities have something to aim toward that would truly make a difference for the planet and, of course, for the residents themselves. Welcome to Edenicity, best practices for sustainably abundant cities. Now, there are some really handy metrics out there already. There's the WalkScore, for example, where you can enter in the location and it will give you a score from 1 to 100 of how your city compares to other cities in terms of walkability, transit, and bicycle accessibility. And as you can see, Columbus is in the bottom half. There's also a rating system for buildings called the Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design System, or LEED, that assigns buildings points based on how healthy, energy efficient, and cost-saving they are. These are really great systems that will be a huge benefit to every Edenicity-related project. They're objective, they're broad-focused, and data-driven. But to my way of thinking, they don't integrate in the ecological imperatives of relayering our environment to have ecological efficiency. So I've created the Edenicity score, or simply Edenicity, which is a measure that I originally envisioned as a combination of ecological and economic abundance, but in detail works out to be focused on land use, cities as a whole, and very clear end goals, which would be meeting our housing, energy, transportation, and food needs all within a very compact footprint. Unlike the LEED and WalkScore metrics, which are based on painstaking data, the Edenicity score is subjective because we're looking at clear end goals. And those goals should show up in our day-to-day experience and should be immediately apparent to the residents of any project, neighborhood, or city that has a high Edenicity rating. So let's take a look at the Edenicity rating system. You can find it on the Edenicity.com website. And you go to the map and then to your Edenicity score. We'll get back to the map a little bit later on. And it asks you, what's your city's Edenicity? Adjust the sliders below to describe how people live in your city. And then scroll down to the end to see the city's Edenicity score. There's six questions in four categories. Let's get into the details. The first one asks whether people run errands without encountering a car. So can you run errands in your city without encountering a car? Believe it or not, as I mentioned a few episodes ago, I spent some of my childhood in a neighborhood where I could walk to a playground, an elementary school, a grocery store, a convenience store, and all of my friends' houses without ever encountering a car. Not a driveway, not a crosswalk, nothing. So there are cities, even now, this was in a part of Detroit, where a few people can run errands without encountering a car. But in the case of Columbus, I've never seen such an area, so I'm going to mark that as people never run errands without encountering a car. Here's why this is so important. Cars use a good fraction of the surface area of a city. If you talk to most planners, the numbers are somewhere between nearly 20% and maybe 35%. But that's just looking at streets and parking along the streets. If you also add in parking lots, just the parking lots alone in downtown areas can be anywhere from 25 to 50% of the area of a city. And our responses to cars, such as setbacks and green strips, can greatly magnify how much area cars demand of us in a city. It can go up to 80%. By contrast, public transit occupies 10 to 30 times less space. Let me show you what that looks like. So in this chart on the far left, you can see that cars can carry 1.5 to 2,000 people per hour per lane. And in the same space, a bus rapid transit can carry several tens of thousands. Suburban rail can carry 60,000 plus people per track per hour, with far less parking and service requirements on either end. By the way, going back to this picture, there is a public transit system visible, but it's hard to see, isn't it? Car traffic is 20 times more dangerous than public transit. And you can see in this picture, the cars are at a standstill, whereas the public transit would no doubt be many times faster in this situation. The other thing that's often not well appreciated about public transit is that it is much more scalable than car and road infrastructure. It can accommodate orders of magnitudes increases in demand without additional disruption compared to, say, a road widening project, which gives you just a little bit of return for a lot of disruption. So in Edenicity, we really are looking at, ideally, removing all cars. Let's see what that looks like. For a high Edenicity score, all people would be able to run errands without encountering a car. Now, if you're new to the channel, you're probably thinking, well, wait a minute, what about delivery vehicles? What about emergency services? What about people with special transportation needs who may not be able to walk or take a bicycle? I covered all of that in the Ecology of Transit episode, which I'll link at the end and in the description and pinned comment. But the bottom line was that in a city that is more compact due to getting rid of the car, those services are easily addressed with much lighter weight, slower moving vehicles. Let's move on to housing. In Columbus, I would say that some people live in connected up apartments or townhouses. It's mostly a city full of detached houses. Here's why that matters. Even low-rise apartments use 20 to 30 times less land than detached houses. Keep in mind how this fits into our end game, which is we're shrinking all of our individual uses within the city to make it more convenient and also to open up space for more agriculture within city limits. It asks whether people know and trust their neighbors, and whether people can afford housing, education, and healthcare. Let's dig into these from an ecological perspective. Knowing and trusting our neighbors is really a matter of how well designed an environment is and the quality of shared amenities. If there's more places for people to mingle, then it stands to reason it's easier for them to get to know each other in healthy ways. But the design of those spaces, the detailed psychological underpinnings of how those spaces are designed, is paramount. Let me show you what I mean. In the book Happy City, Charles Montgomery makes a really strong case for chunking social spaces in areas of increasing intimacy. Let me read a passage from his book. He writes about a stunning 1973 study in which psychologist Andrew Baum compared the behavior of residents of two starkly different college dormitories at Stony Brook University in Long Island, New York. Let's look at what those dorms looked like. In one residence, 34 students lived in double bedrooms along a single corridor, a bit like a hotel, except that they shared one large bathroom and a lounge area at the end of the hallway. It's this picture here, times eight, down a long hallway with a bathroom and a lounge at the end. Then he writes, the other building housed just as many students, but the floors were broken up into suites with two or three bedrooms each, sharing a lounge and a small bathroom. All the students were randomly assigned, but their reaction to their environment was far from random. Let's pause and take a look at this suite. So this is six students in three rooms sharing a bathroom and a little lounge. And then out this door would be 10 other suites like this. So it's the same number of students with the same amount of space allocated, but the space has been divided a little bit differently. The students who lived in the corridor block felt crowded and stressed out. That's this block here. They complained about unwanted social interactions. The problem was that the long corridor design made it almost impossible for them to choose whom they bumped into and how often. There was no in-between space. You were either in your room or out in the public zone of the hallway. The design didn't merely make the students irritated, it changed the way they treated one another. The corridor residents did not become friends. The suite residents did. The corridor residents were less helpful to one another. They actually avoided one another, and they grew more antisocial as the year progressed. Amazingly, the students carried their behavior with them to other parts of their lives. At one point, the students were called to an office and asked to wait for an appointment along with one of their neighbors. Unlike the corridor residents, the suite residents chatted and made eye contact with each other. They reassured each other. They sat closer together. And yes, this is actually a contemporary view of these suites from the Stony Brook pages. So this architecture that was built in the 1970s or before endures to this day with social consequences, both good and bad. The quality of how a space is organized matters. And it's not necessarily the case that this suite is any more expensive to build than this, although with all these bump outs, I'm guessing it is slightly. But the social benefits sound like they are highly valuable too. The bottom line for Edenicity is whether in the end people know and trust their neighbors. I'm going to be a little bit charitable and give Columbus a middling score on this one, that some people know and trust their neighbors. From what I've seen, even in neighborhoods with detached houses, you see these long blocks just fronting the street and with really huge setbacks. The street, by and large, is deserted in many areas of town. So the feeling that I get in many areas is that people really don't get to know their neighbors, even with detached houses. And finally, affordability is really important. I'm going to give Columbus a middling score on this one as well, because if a good fraction of humanity has to live in a way that's harmful to the earth, then we lose our green credentials. Okay, but the question is, how do we make neighborhoods affordable? As I wrote in my book, Housing in Four Cities, which I've also put a link to in the description, the key there was to increase supply. And cities that found ways to do that were able to bring prices down. In addition to that, and we're really seeing this now in the U.S. today, finding ways to limit speculation in real estate as a buy and hold asset is really key to helping to bring prices down. Builders want to build. So in this case, the limitation is within the neighborhood. Oh, and hey, while we're talking about books, since it's back to school time, I thought I'd mention that I wrote another book for STEM students, science, technology, engineering, math, economics, statistics, and accounting students, people in the quantitative disciplines, who may find themselves really excited about their career path, but struggling to pass the exams. Believe me, I've been there. This is the system that I started to develop back in college when I went from flunking a midterm to walking out of a 3-hour final in 40 minutes in the same class a few weeks later with a 98%. I've used this system to help many people over the decades. And because I don't want to be a test-taking coach, I just distilled all of my thoughts into a low-cost book and self-published it. So if you know anybody who could use a boost in their science, technology, engineering, math, etc., send them this link. This would be a really good time of year to do it. All right, now that we've heard from our sponsor, let's move on to energy, which I covered in depth in the energy playlist on this channel. But let's see how this plays out in our city ranking. So in some cities, people pretty much never use renewable energy. In Columbus, we're actually transitioning to everybody using renewable energy. The city is moving in the direction of aggregating all of the energy into renewables, but we're still in transition, so I'll just put some for that one. And the idea here is whether we can generate all of our energy renewably, preferably on site. And in future versions of the Edenicity ratings, I'll make the distinction about whether the energy is within city limits or not. And then finally, there's food. Now, given that 44% of the land is agriculture, and cities occupy just 2.8% of the land, and that small-scale farms are 6 to 100 times more space efficient than industrial farms, it's possible that we may be able to grow most or even all of our food within city limits. So our final question gets at that issue, whether people eat food within walking distance or not. Now, I've actually eaten food grown within walking distance. It was not a big fraction of my diet, and there are quite a few public gardens scattered throughout Columbus that certainly help fill the nutrition gaps in the many food deserts in this city. So I'm going to leave this at few people. It really isn't that many who have routine access to homegrown food. And so then we get our score. Columbus's Edenicity is 38. Well, let's see how that looks on the map. If you check the Edenicity world map, the way this works is anybody can jump on Edenicity and figure out the Edenicity score of their city. But if you want to put it on the map, then you need to join the Edenicity membership, fill out a quick survey, and remember your score, and just put it on the map. Over time, I'll be improving the aesthetics of this map as it starts to populate with people's Edenicity scores. This updates in near real time. When people fill out the survey, it might take up to an hour for that information to propagate to the server and appear on the map. But eventually, your city appears. All right, so let's take a look at some of these cities. So here's Columbus with 38, Detroit, 37. This averages scores. Thousand Oaks, California, 37. Honolulu, 33. Cotacachi has an Edenicity of 57. So far that's the winner. And if you want to add your city to the map, just head over to edenicity.com, visit the map, figure the score, and then add your city. What could be easier? Here's that episode that I promised. And thanks so much to these wonderful urbanists who've joined the Patreon community and are helping to make Edenicity actually happen. I've put links to everything in the description below and eventually in the pinned comment. Take care, stay green, see you next time.